Hello everyone, I am Dr. Dinesh Vamanrao Deshmukh, working as Assistant Professor at Department of Chemistry, G.H. Raisoni Academy of Engineering and Technology, Nagpur. As I belong to Department of Applied Chemistry, I am going to teach you Applied Chemistry. First of all, we have to discuss about what is chemistry and correlationship between applied chemistry and pure chemistry. Now, chemistry. The word chemistry is derived from word alchemy meaning art of metal casting. Broadly, chemistry deals with the study of matters, its composition, its properties, and various chemical reactions involved in it. Now, applied chemistry and pure chemistry. So, basically, pure chemistry is nothing but the pure research in the field of chemistry performed by the scientist. So, pure chemistry deals with how things work, how they react, and applied chemistry. Now, if you are more curious person about chemistry, then you should have some question of chemistry. Why mercury is a liquid at room temperature? Why water freezes? Why water expands at its freezes? It is about pure chemistry. Now, applied chemistry. So, applied chemistry looks at how our knowledge of chemistry is useful to improve the things. So, therefore, applied chemistry uses our existing knowledge to improve things and can be useful. Now, our curriculum is divided into two different semesters. So, first semester deals with engineering chemistry, and second semester deals with materials chemistry. So, first, engineering chemistry. So, engineering chemistry comprises of four different units. First, water technology for 12 marks. Second, corrosion science . Third, construction material . Fourth, green chemistry and battery technology . Now, first chapter is water technology. As we know that water is very important, water covers about 71% of the total earth surface. Water is vital for life. Life cannot sustain without it. It is not only important for various leaves of plant and animal, but also finds unique position in the field of, in the industry. Probably the most important use of water in industry is for steam generation. It is also used as a coolant in many production and thermal chemical plants. In addition to it, water is also useful in production of steel, rayon, paper, textile, drinking, firefighting, irrigation, etc., etc. As we know that our human body contains around 55 to 78% of water. Therefore, the quality of water which we drink is more important. Therefore, the drinking water should be perfectly clear, clean, and it is free from disease producing pathogenic bacteria. Now, leading to contents of the water technology first unit. So, first, which are various impurities present in water? There are three different types of impurities present in water. First is biological impurities, colloidal impurities, dissolved impurities. Then what is hard water? So, hard water is nothing but hard water, soft water, and hardness of water. So, hard water is nothing but the water which when react with soap solution do not form lather easily is called as hard water, whereas, and it is due to the presence of calcium and magnesium salts. whereas soft water means the water which when treated with soap solution forms lather easily. Now hardness of water. So hardness of water is nothing but it is the property which is due to the presence of calcium and magnesium salts which prevent lather formation with soap solution. There are two types of hardness of water, temporary hardness and permanent hardness. First is temporary hardness. So temporary hardness is nothing but the hardness which is due to the presence of carbonate, bicarbonates of calcium and magnesium is called as temporary hardness. So temporary hardness can be easily removed. Then second one is permanent hardness. So permanent hardness is nothing but the hardness which is due to the presence of chloride, sulfate and nitrates of calcium and magnesium. It can be removed by various processes, softening processes like lime soda process, zeolite process and ion exchange method. After that, domestic and industrial water treatment, the treatments which are given to water for domestic purpose and for industrial purpose. For domestic purpose, first treatment is sedimentation, in which suspended impurities from the water is removed, in which the water is allowed to stay undisturbed for some time in a large tank so that all suspended impurities can be removed. Second procedure for domestic water treatment is coagulation. In this, this is the process of removal of colloidal impurities from water with the help of addition of third substance called as coagulant. There are three types of coagulant. First one is alum, ferrous sulfate and sodium aluminate. After that, third process is filtration. So we all know that filtration is the process of water clarification by porous material. The last step of water treatment process for domestic purpose is sterilization. So sterilization is nothing but the process of removal, it is the process of removal of disease producing bacteria or pathogens from water and making it safe for drinking purpose. So these are nothing but the treatment given to water for domestic purpose. Now we will see the treatments, various treatments given to industrial purpose. First, the softening of water. So softening of water involves means the removal of hardness producing salts. As I told earlier, water is useful in a steam generation for industries. So for generation steam, we have to use boilers. So before entering water into the boiler, the treatment which are given to water is called as external treatment. So first treatment is lime soda process, second is zeolite process, third is ion exchange process. So these are processes useful to remove hardness producing calcium and magnesium salts from water. So even after treatments given to water, the water we get is not free from any impurities. Then we have to add certain chemicals into the boiler. So there are two treatments. First is external treatment, which involves lime soda process, zeolite process and ion exchange process. Then another one is internal treatment. Internal treatment means the chemicals which are added into the boiler to convert hard precipitate into soft one and which can be easily removed. So for that, first is colloidal conditioning, second is carbonate conditioning, third is Calgon conditioning and fourth one is phosphate conditioning. Then boiler troubles. So trouble, we all know that trouble means problems. So boiler trouble, so problems which are occurring inside a boiler during steam generation is called as boiler trouble. So first trouble is boiler corrosion. So we all know that corrosion. So corrosion is nothing but the unwanted decay or destruction of material by chemical or electrochemical contact with its surrounding. So second one is scale and sludge. So scale is nothing but hard adherent precipitate form inside a boiler which may be problematic for our boiler due to that wastage of fuel is needed. Second one is sludge, scale and sludge. So scale is nothing but hard adherent precipitate form inside a boiler. Second one is sludge, loose and slippy mass form inside a boiler is called as sludge. So first boiler trouble is boiler corrosion, second one is scale and sludge, third one is caustic embrittlement. The word itself suggests that caustic means basic substances, embrittlement, brittle means hard. The boiler becomes brittle due to the accumulation of caustic substances like NaOH inside a boiler is called as caustic embrittlement. And fourth trouble is carryover. During the formation of steam, there are some water droplets are carried out outside the boiler. So it is called as a carryover. So these are boiler troubles. After that, lastly, desalination of seawater. So, desalination of seawater means it is the process of removal of common salt from water is called as desalination of water. It can be achieved by using two different methods. First one is reverse osmosis method and second one is electrodialysis method. So, it is all about brief discussion about water technology, first unit, after for 12 marks. After that, second unit is corrosion science for 10 marks in Nagpur University curriculum. So, what is corrosion? As I told earlier, corrosion is nothing but destruction or decay or unwanted destruction of any material by chemical or electrochemical attack with its surrounding is called as corrosion science. We all know that almost all metals present on earth crust is present in their combined state, like in the form of oxides, in the form of sulfates, in the form of chlorides, carbonate, silicate, etc., means in the form of ores. So, considerable amount of energy has to be supplied it to extract the metals. So, it is called as extractive metallurgy. So, it is nothing but reduction, whereas corrosion is nothing but oxidation. Hence, we can say that corrosion is a reverse of extractive metallurgy. So, in this we have to discuss about factors which influence the corrosion. So, there are many factors which influence the corrosion. First one is nature of metal, purity of metal, then nature of corroding environment. After that, mechanisms of corrosion. First mechanism is chemical mechanism and chemical theory of corrosion. Second one is electrochemical theory of corrosion. So, chemical theory of corrosion involves the main topic or basic topic of corrosion is Peeling-Bedworth rule. So, what is Peeling-Bedworth rule? So, Peeling-Bedworth rule is about metal oxide layer. Metal oxide means after corrosion, means after oxidation, there is a formation of metal oxide. If the volume of metal oxide, suppose it is metal now and it is metal oxide all part. If the volume of metal oxide, now it is more, if the volume of metal oxide is more than the metal from which it is formed, then that layer is called as non-porous in nature and it is protective. Hence, it stops the further corrosion of metal. So, example is aluminium. So, it is first part. Now, second part, if the volume of metal oxide is lesser one. Now, suppose this one, it is metal oxide and this one is metal. So, we can see that it is metal large part and it is metal oxide small part. If the volume of metal oxide form is smaller than the metal from which it is formed, then we can say that that layer is non-protective in nature and it is porous in nature, means further corrosion continues. So, it is about Peeling-Bedworth rule comes under chemical theory of corrosion. After that, electrochemical theory of corrosion. So, electrochemical theory of corrosion or mechanism of electrochemical corrosion can be well explained by liberation of hydrogen and absorption of oxygen. So, it is about electrochemical corrosion. After that, types of corrosion. So, types of corrosion involves pitting corrosion. If on the metal there are some holes or dots or pits are called as are formed, then we can say it is a pitting corrosion. Second one is water line corrosion. Now, we can say that when we store water in a large tank or large metallic tank for some time, we can observe that corrosion occurs just below water line, means it is nothing but water line corrosion. Third one is intergranular corrosion. So, intergranular corrosion basically occurs in alloys, means during casting there is a formation of grain boundaries. So, it is called as a intergranular corrosion. So, after that, prevention of corrosion. So, we all know that we cannot prevent it, but we can reduce it by applying some methods. So, for that there are cathodic and anodic protection. So, now what is cathodic protection? So, cathodic protection means the metallic structure to be protected from corrosion is forced to behave like a cathode. We all know that anodes corrodes. Corrodes means oxidation. Oxidation means loss of electron. Means in any electrochemical series, which one behaving as an anode is corrodes. So, in cathodic protection, what we have to do? The metallic structure which is to be protected forced to behave as a cathode. either by applying it to a more anodic material or by applying impressed current. If by applying more anodic metal, if we have connected metal to a more anodic metal by a wire, then we can say that it is sacrificial anode method. Why it is sacrificial anode method? So sacrificial means for protecting that metal, certain metal which is more negative one is sacrifice himself to protect that. Hence it is called as a sacrificial anode method for cathodic protection. After that, protective coating. So protective coating involves, so any coatings which are coated on the metallic surface is called as protective coating. Then there are many methods like galvanization. So galvanization is nothing but it is the process of coating of thin layer of zinc metal on the zinc metal on another metallic part which is to be protected is called as galvanizing. Then tinning, the coating of tin on metal is called as tinning. Likewise, electroplating. So this is all about corrosion science. Now third unit is construction materials. So we all know that nowadays construction materials we need gravel, sand, bricks, cement, etc. Out of that, cement is mostly important, mostly used and widely used material. So cement is a binder and which can bind any other materials like gravels or sand into it. So basically cement is made up from two types of materials. First one is argillaceous method, which contains aluminium and silicon, and second one is calcareous material, which is mainly a calcium containing compound. The basic constituent of cement can be well remembered by using mnemonics called as, just like a Ohm Psi, we can say LM Psi according to their composition. So L for lime, M for magnesia, S for silica, A for alumina, and I for iron oxide. So next part is construction of, next part is manufacturing of cement using wet process. After that, heat of hydration of cement and soundness of cement. So we all know that when we have added water into the cement, there is a liberation of large amount of heat, and that heat is called as heat of hydration of cement. Whereas soundness of cement, so soundness of cement is related with the expansion in volume due to slow hydration and hydrolysis reaction of cement clinkers like C2S and C3S, means dicalcium silicate and tricalcium silicate. There is a expansion, there is small change in the volume of cement structure, is called as soundness of cement. After that, microscopic constituents of cement. Now what is microscopic constituent of cement? The main components which are present in cement, which are formed during manufacturing of cement, we can say it as a clinkers. So there are four different microscopic constituents. First one is tricalcium aluminate, second one is dicalcium silicate, third one is tricalcium silicate, fourth one is tetracalcium aluminoferrite. We all know that when we mix water with the cement, suddenly there is a evolution of large amount of heat, and that large amount of heat is mainly due to the component called as tricalcium aluminate, because it sets in around half an hour and liberated around 881 kilojoule per kg of heat. During first half an hour, when we mix water with cement, during first half an hour there is a reaction of water with C3A, tricalcium aluminate. After that, C4AF, that completed within a 1 hour. After that, C3S, tricalcium silicate. The binding or hardening property in a cement is due to C2S. C3S requires 7 days for hardening and requires 10 hours for complete setting. Means during construction, we water it, we curd it. So it is only for the late reaction of C2S and C3S, and C2S requires 28 days for complete hardening process. So it is all about microscopic constituent of cement. After that, types of cement. Now depending on our use, there are many types of cement. First one is rapid hardening cement. Suppose we have to make emergency roads. So which cement we will use? For that we have to use rapid hardening cement. In this cement there is higher percentage of C3S. It takes 7 days for hardening, means during early period it hardens. So for rapid hardening cement there is higher percentage of C3S, tricalcium silicate. Now second type of cement is low heat cement. Now low heat cement means where large amount of concrete is required, like in the manufacturing of dam, in the construction of dam large amount of heat is requires there. So which cement we will use? Low heat cement. So why? So what is composition of low heat cement? Is there C3A is more? No. Why? Because C3A liberated large amount of heat, means 881 kilojoule per kg of heat. Then C3S liberated 502 kilojoule per kg of heat. So these two are in lesser percentage in that low heat cement. Now the third part, third cement is high alumina cement. High alumina cement, word itself says that high alumina, means alumina content is more in that cement. It is useful in the refractories. After that rapid hard, after that white cement, in this percentage of iron oxide is lesser, it can be used for a decorative purposes. Now next point is fly ash as a cementing material and ready mix concrete. First let us see what is ready mix concrete. We all know that concrete is nothing but mixture of cement, water and gravels. So ready mix concrete, the concrete which is made up in batching plant or in industry itself and delivered to a work site by a truck mounted transit mixture is called as ready mix concrete. The concrete which is already prepared in a batching plant or in industry and delivered to a work site is called as ready mix concrete. And last topic of this unit is fly ash as a cementing material. We all know that fly ash is nothing but residue generated after combustion of bituminous coal in a thermal power plant. So it contains higher amount of silica, hence we can use it as a cementing material. It's all about construction material. Now lastly but not the least, green chemistry and battery technology. So word green chemistry, we all know that green is a symbol of safe and eco-friendly, and chemistry, green chemistry means safe chemistry, but we all know that chemistry is not safe, it is hazardous, it is harmful, because chemistry involves use of hazardous and harmful chemicals. How we can say green chemistry means safe chemistry? So for that scientists called as Paul Anastas proposed some principles which reduces hazard, harmfulness, cost, economy and risk factor. So green chemistry is all about reducing waste, reducing hazard, reducing risk, harmfulness and cost and energy also. Okay, so now what is green chemistry? So green chemistry is nothing but the utilization of set of principles which reduces the use or generation of set of principles in the manufacturing of design, in the manufacturing of any chemical product. So first principle is maximize atom economy, prevention of waste. So first is maximize atom economy. So what is atom economy? Means whatever is the our expenses, we must get complete part of that. So higher is the atom economy, it is good for us. Second one is prevention of waste. So it is better to prevent waste rather than treat it or clean it after it is formed. Then likewise there are 12 principles, the use of safer solvent, the use of safer chemicals, the use of auxiliaries, the use of catalyst, use of biodegradable materials, inherently safer chemicals use, then accident prevention and pollution control. So basically green chemistry is a topic approaches towards awareness about chemical awareness about pollution prevention. After that carbon credit. So carbon credit topic comes under green chemistry. So carbon credit is nothing but it is a again awareness spreading awareness among people about pollution prevention. So we all know that burning of fossil fuel increases day by day. So burning of fossil fuel leads to formation of greenhouse gases like CO2. So carbon credit is nothing but a generic term for a tradable certificate or permit representing right to emit 1 ton of carbon dioxide or any other greenhouse gases. Means a company is allowed to emit only 1 ton of CO2. If higher, then they have to pay expenses for that. So it is nothing but carbon credit. After that, supercritical CO2 or supercritical fluid. So supercritical CO2 or supercritical fluid is nothing but at a temperature and pressure beyond its critical point, certain fluid do not behaving as a distinct phase as a liquid and gas is called as supercritical fluid. So supercritical CO2 is good example of that. We can use it as extraction of coffee from caffeine, as a dry cleaning, etc., etc. And lastly, biocatalysis. So word biocatalyst, the catalyst which is biologically. So example of biocatalyst means the material which speed up the chemical reaction, the material which speed up the biological reaction. Example is enzymes and protein. Now battery technology. Last is battery technology. So what are batteries? So we all know that batteries are nothing but it is the electrochemical devices which convert chemical energy into electrical energy. There are two types of batteries. First one is primary battery and another one is secondary battery. So primary battery cannot be recharged again and again. Once we have used that battery and we have to discard it. Whereas secondary battery means the battery which can be reused again and again. Means there are reversible reaction takes place. The example of secondary batteries are first lead acid battery, lithium ion battery, nickel cadmium battery, etc. So it is all about the complete syllabus of first semester, which comprises of 4 different units. First is water technology for 12 marks, corrosion science for 10 marks, construction materials for 10 marks, green chemistry and battery technology for 8 marks. So latter part of material chemistry we will discuss in our next lecture. Thank you.